control them during the decade of child disease. And the sentence her character was kidnapped and I was handcuffed to a bike. It was 4 in the morning, I was so tired, and I just thought, like, I don't think this is safe. Dane's got a breakout role at age 14. She grew up in Soho, where her mother ran a daycare. Sometimes difficult for her fellow officers to tell if she's on the verge of a breakthrough or if she's being paranoid during a manic episode. Dane was a teenager when she became known for her starring role in the series My So-Called Life, about a girl in high school dealing with anxieties about sexuality, school, and parents. The show was canceled in 1995 after one season, but it's had a long afterlife. Dane has revealed a remarkable emotional range in the role of Carrie Matheson, has won 2 Emmys and 2 Golden Globes. The focus of the series was initially on fighting terrorism, but more recently, Homeland dealt with Russian meddling in American politics and a conspiracy within the American government to take down the president. At the end of last season, Carrie was captured by Russian intelligence. She was imprisoned, interrogated, and her medication was withheld, which left her in a psychotic state when she was released. In the first episode of the new season, the new president wants to end the war in Afghanistan, and Carrie's old boss at the CIA, who's now the National Security Advisor, wants to send her there because she has so many contacts in Kabul. But some officers in the CIA are worried that she might have been compromised while held by the Russians. In this scene, she's being questioned by a CIA officer.
You were detained in Russia for 213 days?
Yes.
You were interrogated for the first.
A colonel named Sergei Talbot, most of the time, anyway, Jeremy.
Why do you scum?
All of this is in the file.
This is a big file. Can you tell me why you scum to Jeremy?
Because I don't know what Stacey's happened.
Was that strategic?
No, no. I was in the midst of a foreign psychosis. They withheld my medication. It took about 20 days for me to devolve into a not very helpful subject, but they kept at it for another week or so. I can't give you an exact figure. After that, it's all either blank or a series of images that don't much comport with realities. If we're doing this a slow way, maybe I will take some more.
Doug informs me you'd like to be reinstated at the agency.
Yes. Yes, I would like that very much.
A security clearance is not an option without just 108 days at the company.
Yeah, I know that. That's why I've been working so hard with Dr. Foley and Doug, trying to fill in the gaps. Did they give you the impression that wasn't the case?
No. Did they tend to betray your contract? Deception indeed. So, you're going to have to bear with me.
Which questions?
You said it was usually tied up, but not always.
I'd like to know which questions, please.
Quite a few, actually.
Such as?
Have you complied with the Foreign Intelligence Officer or Service?
What, so what does that mean? Are you accusing me of something?
Could be a lot of things. Giving up sources and methods, working for the enemy. You tell me.
Claire Danes, welcome to Fresh Air. Thank you so much. So, Homeland is often been really timely, and in this season, the new president is trying, through Saul Berenson, the National Security Advisor, who has been your boss at the CIA, he's trying to negotiate peace with the Taliban. And right now, the Trump administration is trying to negotiate peace with the Taliban. Of the events in Homeland that have been echoed in your mind, what's the one that really
to people in the clandestine services and journalists and political insiders. And, you know, we've kind of taken a deep dive into what's churning and what's going to be especially relevant in a year's time when the show is going to air. But even so, there's always some kind of inexplicable force at play that creates some mirroring that there's no way we could have even anticipated.
At the end of the previous season, season 7, when you were imprisoned by the Russians, they withheld your medications for bipolar disorder. And so when you're released, you're in full psychosis, and your eyes are just wild and unfocused, and you're not registering what you see. You see Saul Berenson, you know, who you're very close to. He had been your boss at the CIA. He's played by Mandy Patinkin. And it looks like you're running toward him because he's there to receive you. But actually, you run right past him because nothing is registering on you. You're just in a state of wild fear.
Mm-hmm.
What impact did it have on you mentally to inhabit someone with a mental health disorder who is forced off of her meds?
Well, it felt like a privilege, honestly. I mean, that's one of the reasons why I love doing what we do as actors, is that we get to go to the outer reaches of our imagination and empathize with people who might seem very remote or other or inaccessible. And suddenly you get to feel not only intimate with them, but sort of merged with them. You get to embody them. And it's really fascinating, you know, to attempt to look at the world through such a different lens. So, yeah, and I actually, you know what, honestly, it's so interesting just talking to you now, imagining it. My body is starting to change, like my heart rate is starting to quicken, and I feel a little bit more adrenalized, and it's so interesting. It's like you have a contact high just through your imagination. Even just recalling it now, it's starting to happen to my system involuntarily, and I don't quite understand how that works, but it does.
Do you feel like your voice changed, as you were saying?
Yeah, it's true.
What else changed?
I don't know. Like, it's really my heart. My heart started like really racing. And sound guys on the show would pick it up through the mic.
You pick up your heartbeat?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. You have a mic on your chest by your heart. But you know, it's just so wild, this acting thing. Still kind of in the street.
So John Lahr in the New Yorker wrote a great profile of you a while ago, and he wrote that there were a couple of times in your childhood that you described as dalliances with madness, and you had terrifying visions of ghosts and gargoyles emerging from the shower head and from shapes in the woodwork, and that brought you to a psychiatrist. Do you have an understanding of what happened?
I don't really. I mean, I think I probably had a very active imagination and was learning how to rifle it, you know, to differentiate the real from the unreal. And that takes discipline, and I think I was still just developing it. I also think maybe there was kind of burgeoning OCD, because a lot of the behavior was ritualistic, and you know, these creatures that I saw in quotes would talk to me and tell me to do things. Like, you know, I remember one time I was supposed to hold a contorted position for 20 minutes or something, but I think there were some overlaps there, and it didn't take long to undo it. As soon as I found myself in a therapist's office at 6, I was like, oh, I think I have a problem. and as soon as I became conscious of it, it almost immediately started to dissipate.
So when you were young and you had those visions, those images in your head, were you afraid to go to sleep? Afraid of what?
I was terrified of the dark, which lasted for a long time. Like, even in college, I remember if I had to pee in the night, you know, in my dorm, I would call my boyfriend and wake him up so he could escort me to the bathroom. I mean, how ridiculous. I have to say, at 40, I have I've matured past that, but no, the messages about, you know, yeah, it lasted for quite a while. plane of the performing arts, and that was the one that I was most most interested in. But somebody told me around the age of about 9 that most actors don't make much money, which I found concerning. So I amended my plans to be a therapist and do acting workshops on the side, and that was my plan for a good year. And I don't know how seriously my parents took me, you know, but I started taking acting classes, and I went to a performing arts junior high school. I met other kids who were doing it professionally, and, you know, and I figured out how to get an agent, and it was so...
So you figured out how to get an agent? Not your parents?
Yeah.
How did you figure it out?
Talking to my friends at school who had, you know, were doing this for real. And my dad had been a photographer, so he had a doctor in our loft, and the woman who was writing it out took my headshots and we sent them out. And it was very makeshift. I just used whatever resources he had.
So how old were you when you had your first headshots?
I was 12.
What were they like?
We took them on the streets of New York, and I kind of have a feeling that we may have taken them on the block that I now live on in the West Village, because like people take headshots there block by block. I think it's like headshot block. I think I'm making that up, but you know, yeah.
So you know, you said that one of the downsides of acting when you were young is that you acted on the whole weren't going to make a lot of money. Did your parents not have a lot of money, and was that like an issue you grew up with?
Well, they had been artists, and then they did take on more conventional jobs eventually, maybe for financial reasons, so they may have intuited that a little bit. My dad became a contractor, and my mom ran a toddler school in a loft. And again, I became involved, I was populated by artists, and I think I saw what that struggle could be.
So how old were you when your mother opened a toddler school in Iran?
I was 4.
Were you home when school was in session, or did they send you
to
it? But...
No. I was in arrived as I was kind of getting ready to go to school. An hour or two when I got back home from school. So I know a lot of nursery rhymes, a lot. It served me well in the raising of my boys. There were like raisins everywhere. There was diluted apple juice. in the fridge, always.
What was it like to have your home all day as a toddler?
It wasn't exactly easy. It didn't strictly feel like my home. I knew I had to share it, and I knew I had to share my mom, which wasn't always the best feeling. But she was really celebrated in our little world of Soho. She was like the mother groups of downtown New York.
Did any of the kids in your mother's daycare center grow up to be people who you became friends with?
Well, actually, I am friends with Lena Dunham, and one of the first things she ever told me when we met years ago was that she was rejected from my mom's school.
Oh, she was rejected from her?
She was a reject, yeah. It was not personal, I'm sure. I do run into kids now who were in baby school. And it's bizarre because I do really remember them when they were bald and pre-verbal.
So you grew up in Soho. Did a lot of things that seemed weird to other people seem totally normal to you?
Well, I still remember the feeling of the cobblestones being in the back of my mom's bike. My mom would cycle with me in the back, in the baby seat in the back, and I still remember like kind of bracing myself for the curbs and the feeling of the cobblestones. And especially back then, it was a much more raw place. I mean, I remember I went to Washington Square Daycare, and we would play in the park, and we literally collected crack vials. That was a game. I only remember it because the teachers saw us do that, and they got kind of panicked, right? moth to flame, you know, pretty dramatic. And that was true of my parents too, and I think it was a generational choice, you know, where my parents weren't exactly hippies, but they came of age in a hippie culture, and there weren't those kind of strict lines between adults and kids, for better or worse, right? And we were invited to engage in conversations that were pretty heady and sophisticated, and I think that maybe contributed to my thinking that I could be a serious performer at a really young age, because I had been listened to and considered, like, earnestly.
When you were 12, you were offered a part on the soap opera One Life to Live, and you turned it down. Were you worried about selling out when you were 12?
I was worried about selling out, and I also suspected that, well, I knew that I was malleable as a performer, that I was still very new at this and kind of fungible, and I didn't want to develop bad habits, which I might do on a soap opera. So it was like self-protective. And that sounds so precocious. I don't know. I haven't had as much integrity ever. I remember my agent was rather surprised that that was a pass, such a clear pass for me. But yeah, no, I can't account for these things. They're funny to me now, especially now that I have kids, because I just think of, you know, age so differently. My boys seem so tiny, and to think that in 2 years' time, Cyrus might be thinking about these ideas is incomprehensible, you know.
Who told you about, you know, selling out on a soap opera? Where did you get that from?
I don't think anybody told me that. I don't know where I got that. But I had been working in, I mean, it sounds a little silly to say that, but like, I had done stuff at PS122 and Mama, and I had been working with fairly radical storytellers, you know. I bet I was exposed to some sort of conversation that I can't remember now that maybe helped me think in those terms. I don't know.
Your first television role, I think, was on an episode of Law & Order.
Mm-hmm.
What season? Which season was it? Who were the detectives? And
oh, gosh. It must have been like 91. Oh, I was so excited. I played a teenage murderer.
Oh, you were the murderer?
Oh, yeah. Wow. Oh, yeah. I played the daughter of a prostitute. I didn't know that she'd been a prostitute. I thought that she was a model, and him/agent or something was grooming me to be a model. And then when my mom found out, she forced him to quit working with me, and I went into a rage, and I murdered him with scissors. Maybe he was a photographer. Maybe that's what. Anyway, yeah. You don't actually see it happen, but you hear about it on the stand.
What was it like to see this on the first time?
Oh, I remember the day after it aired, going on the subway and being sure that I would have a hard time on the commute because so many people would recognize me. I think we had a viewing party at home the night before. It was very sweet. I was just thrilled.
My guest is Claire Danes. She stars in the Showtime series Homeland, which is in its 8th and final season. After a break, we'll talk about starring in the series My So-Called Life when she was in her mid-teens and what her own life was like in her teens. And Justin Chang will review the new film adaptation of Jane Austen's novel Emma. I'm Terry Gross, and this is Fresh Air.
Support for this podcast and the following message come from E-Trade. Investing your money shouldn't require moving mountains, no matter how much or how little experience you have. E-Trade makes investing simpler. And for a limited time, get $100 when you open a new account with just $5,000. It's all about helping your money work hard for you. For more information, visit etrade.com/learn more. E-Trade Securities, LLC. Member SIPC.
Let's get 16 when you auditioned for My So-Called Life. And that show only lasted one season, but it really had a huge impact. Like, it's been described as cable TV before there was really cable, because it was just a much more true to life and sophisticated series than was on record TV, you know, designed for the most part. Mm-hmm. And you were terrific in it. And a lot of people grew up with that show. I mean, it made a really good impression on them.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So you said that your character, Angela, was going through some of the same things that you were going through when you were 13 and auditioned, and then later on when the series actually got made,
which was
about a year later.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So what were some of the things that you were going through that you heard articulated in the series?
Oh, gosh. I mean, your first crush, you know, your face breaking out, that feeling of isolation. I still remember there was one line in the pilot where it said, I can't bring myself to eat in front of my mother. It just means too much to her. Which I, of course, think about all the time now as I tell my kids to eat their spinach. But it was so parallel. And I, sometimes there would be an episode that I didn't fully understand because I actually hadn't arrived at that experience myself, and then a week later I would, you know, so it was this really amazing dance.
So in terms of things that you went through, that your character went through, I want to play a scene from My So-Called Life, and you and Jordan Catalano, who you had a big crush on in this series, had kissed, but the rumor was going around in school that you actually had sex, which you did not. Your mother turns the rumor and decides it's time to have the talk with you about birth control. So here is, I guess, Claire Danes and Bess Armstrong as her mother in a scene for My So-Called Life. And in the scene, she's in her bedroom listening to the Cranberries, and you'll hear that. And I should mention, we're also going to hear Claire Danes doing a voice over in the scene.
We talk. When I was 12, my mother gave me this sex talk. I'm not sure either of us has fully recovered.
Now that you and Jordan are home.
Oh my God.
Mom, please.
Angela, I can accept that you have a boyfriend.
I don't have a boyfriend.
Fine. A pal. A male pal. Whatever word you want to choose. The point is, I'm your mother, and I don't think you're ready.
Mom, please.
I don't think you're ready. But I have to know if this is what's happening, because I don't think that I can keep
Mom, I beg you, stop. I need to know that you're using... I remember how this feels. I do, but it's the times that we live in.
Mom, please. I know you don't want to think about these things. I know that you think you're getting vulnerable.
I don't think that.
You haven't yet. Use some kind of protection if you're going to be...
Mom, I'm not having sex, all right? Really. I'm not even close to an embarrassing degree.
Oh.
Okay.
I'm sorry, honey. I want you to be prepared when the time comes. Whenever the time comes.
It will never come. Mom is Jordan.
Is that what's bothering
you? No, nothing's bothering me.
Something.
Mom, you couldn't possibly understand or help, so please. I don't mean to hurt your feelings, but just please.
So I guess Claire Danes is best I've ever seen for My So-Called Life. Did you have that talk with your mother?
I don't remember having that talk, but I remember when I got my period and my mom kind of discovered it. She was doing the laundry. And she ended up approaching me about that and just feeling like devastated, which was funny because I trusted her and it was so relaxed.
probably thinking, oh, she's Angela from My So-Called Life. And you're talking on to you, Claire Danes, the, you know, personality of your character, Angela. So was that, is it a difficult time to become well known for a role when you're trying to figure out who you are?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, adolescence is a difficult time, full stop. In some ways, I think I ran into acting because I was struggling emotionally just with that reality. I really had a hard time in junior high school and was bullied, and I just hated the social dynamics. And I got to reflect on that in such an incredible way with My So-Called Life. And then I was kind of buffered from the actual experience of it, because I was suddenly in a world full of adults who were much more humane. But at the same time, I was also not having to develop these social strategies, right, or techniques, or, you know, my development emotionally was a little stunted, and that did catch up with me eventually, and that's why, that was a major reason why I chose to stop acting for a time and I went to college.
You said you were bullied. What were you bullied for?
I think I may have been a little annoying. Like I think I was. I always really loved learning, was a very engaged student, which meant like I was what I call ooey. You know, I was gonna have my hand up and was ready to get the answer. And you know, like I didn't quite get the memo that you were supposed to stop doing that, especially as a girl at a certain point. My best friend, we grew up together, and she had a quota. She would only allow herself to answer 3 questions per class. She was the valedictorian, but nobody would ever do it. You know, she knew how to be stealthful.
It's so horrible.
Isn't it horrible? It's horrible. But I just, one, maybe I didn't really understand it, or two, maybe I just didn't have the patience for it. I'm actually not entirely sure which was the real motivating force behind my continuing to be exactly who I was. But I got punished for it. I really did. I got made fun of a lot. And it really took a toll. It was taxing. And I left. I bailed. I stopped going to school.
Let's take a short break here, and then we'll talk some more. If you're just joining us, my guest is Claire Danes. She stars in the Showtime series Homeland, which is now in its 8th and final season. We'll be right back. This is Fresh Air.
This message comes from